The FAABulous team is working on sea ice in a remote Arctic fjord. This is the culmination of 2 years of fieldwork to study some of the smallest organisms living in this seemingly hostile environment. The archipelago of Svalbard is located halfway between the northern tip of mainland Norway and the North Pole. Temperature increase in the Arctic is much higher than the global average, and Svalbard is the area of the Arctic where climate change is most rapid. The most obvious of these changes is the loss of sea ice.
So the Arctic is getting warmer, we know that. It's warming at about twice the rate of the rest of the globe. And so it's really a climatic hotspot. The impact of that is that the sea ice that forms on the ocean surface is forming later and it's melting earlier. So there's less ice in the Arctic, in all areas, in all seasons. The effect of this is to let in more light into the ocean. And so we have an Arctic which is now warmer, it's fresher because of the melt, and it's more illuminated.
So what do all these changes actually mean for animals and plants living in Arctic waters? Most people are familiar with iconic pictures of polar bears perched on tiny blocks of melting sea ice. But in fact, bears are not the only animals at risk of going extinct. An entire ecosystem is threatened as a consequence of the current rapid warming of the Arctic. The researchers and students of the FAABulous team are collecting samples of sea ice and seawater in which they will look for tiny single-celled algae that are invisible without a microscope.
Under the microscope, these ice algae are a really intriguing range of shapes, very small but very intricate, and single cells, lots of strings of cells all joined together, and they all have this green-brown coloration.
So the algae appear green because they contain a green pigment called chlorophyll A. And this pigment actually enables them to do photosynthesis. And photosynthesis is a process in which the algae utilize solar energy to convert CO2 into biomass. Thereby, the algae have exactly the same function as grass and trees on land.
Phytoplankton is the name given to unicellular algae living in the open water. We also have similar unicellular algae living in the ice, known as sea ice algae, and even on the sea floor.
The Arctic winter is long, cold and dark, too dark actually for photosynthesis to take place, which means that algae can start growing only once the light returns in spring again. And that it's actually at that time of the year that they build up the largest biomass, and this might become so dense that you can see this with your bare eye as greenish color in the surface waters, or if you look at the underside of the ice as a brown layer.
The algae are grazed upon by tiny crustaceans, which are themselves fed upon by larger crustaceans, small fish or seabirds. The algae provide the essential energy to the Arctic food chain, which supports animals like fish, seals and eventually polar bears.
When the sun does return, the amount of light that can reach the algae is limited by this cover of sea ice and snow, which just reflects the light straight away.
Sea ice algae have developed special adaptations that enable them to grow with very little light.
Ice algae, they live on the underside of the sea ice, and there are two real benefits to this. One is that it keeps them up as close to the sunlight that is available as possible, rather than sinking into the darkness. But it also gives them protection as a physical habitat away from grazers that would want to eat them.
It is because of their special adaptations that sea ice algae actually are the ones starting the production in spring, and they are marking the transition from winter to spring in Arctic waters long before this becomes visible on land that is still covered by snow and ice.
We know how invaluable algae are to the marine ecosystem, but we know very little about how these organisms will react to the massive changes happening in the Arctic right now. These are key questions for the research project FAABulous. Using different kinds of ships and snowmobiles for their work on the sea ice, the team has followed the development of these algae blooms throughout the changing seasons.
So FAABulous is making measurements at two sites. Van Meerfjorden is ice covered, and another site just further north, Kongsfjorden, is completely ice free. So Kongsfjorden acts a bit like a future Arctic state.
So to compare two fjord systems that are under heavy changing conditions, One of them has lost its ice cover already, and even here in Van Mijnfjorden, where we are sitting on the ice now, there was virtually no sea ice last year, which is unprecedented to the extent I know. This is why we designed this project, to get to use two model systems, so to speak, with contrasting physical conditions and monitor the algae blooms in both of them.
One of the difficulties of working in harsh environments like the Arctic is that we can't collect data for every day of the year, although we want to. And so we have to rely upon autonomous instruments to take measurements for us in our absence.
Apart from knowing how much algae material and which species are present at any time, Eva and her team are also eager to assess their health by studying their physiology.
To sample the algae that are living on the bottom of the ice, we use a core, much like an apple core, to drill through the ice. We then pull the ice out and we chop it up into the sections that we need. And we take these back to the lab and melt them, where we then filter them and store them for later analysis.
If we want to sample ice algae for studying their physiology and their well-being, we need to take extra precautions during sampling. Because if we want to know how they are doing in their natural environment while removing them from it, it is clear that we need to do the measurements as fast as possible and protect it from excessive surface light. So this is the reason why we actually bring a tent to the ice, where we establish a laboratory that enables us to do the measurements on site.
For Anna, the PhD student in the FAABulous project, this means long and tiring hours sitting inside the tent on the sea ice, while her colleagues at least can enjoy the scenery during sampling.
I'm watching out for polar bears. We have to do this at all times when we are doing field work here, because they are living here and that's their place, so to speak. And last time, for example, when we did sample this station here 3 days ago, we saw a mother with her two small cubs wandering along the beach over there.
The researchers conducted an experiment to find out how ice algae and phytoplankton react to increasing light levels, as would occur with thinning sea ice.
For this experiment, we collected phytoplankton and ice algae from their natural habitats and put them into bottles with different gray shades. These bottles were then mounted on a custom-built frame and exposed under the sea ice for 24 hours.
To find out how much carbon the algae have taken up through photosynthesis during these 24 hours, the researchers add radioactive carbon that they can detect afterwards. The different grey shades of the bottles controlled how much light the algae were seeing during the time of the experiment. But does more light actually mean more growth of algae?
Interestingly, the results from our experiments show that there are big differences between phytoplankton and ice algae. Phytoplankton is able to increase their production the more light they get. However, in ice algae, the situation is very different. They reach their carrying capacity, so to speak, already at much lower light intensities, which means even if you increase the light further, they will actually not produce more biomass.
This important result from the FAABulous project indicates that ice algae and phytoplankton might react very differently towards future changes in their environment. FAABulous also sought to examine different biochemical aspects of microalgae, with a special focus on types of lipids.
Lipids are fats, they're concentrated energy, and they're produced by the ice algae. Some of these lipids are only made by the ice algae, making these algae really important for the ecosystem. Omega-3 fatty acids, particularly EPA, which we're probably familiar with from cod liver oil, and DHA similarly, are derived from algae. Heterotrophic organisms, those that feed on other organisms, are unable to biosynthesize. They can't make these chemicals, and so they are absolutely reliant on the algae to produce them. If you imagine taking away the grass from our dairy cows, you can imagine quite easily what will happen. And so I like to think of these algae, the ice algae, as well as the phytoplankton, as being the grass of the ocean.
And so if sea ice disappears, we're talking about the whole system.
So what will a future Arctic look like? And how will the algal blooms change?
In a future Arctic, we expect that the timing of algae blooms will change fundamentally. And we also anticipate that the relative contribution of ice algae versus phytoplankton will be different. And that, as a matter of fact, has big implications for the ecosystem, since it is different grazers that take advantage of these two different algae groups.